So why do the heathen rage and the people imagine a vain thing? The kings of the earth, they set themselves against the Lord and against his anointed. Say, let us break his bands. He said, for he that sits in heaven shall laugh. Can you give the Lord a laugh offering this morning? Glory to God. Despite all that the devil planned for you this year, you are making it through. Come and shout. Glory to God. Father, thank you again for this morning. It's a privilege to be alive, and we are not taking it for granted. It's not because we are good. It's not because we are perfect. It's because we are accepted in the beloved Christ. Thank you for your tender mercies, your loving kindness, and your faithfulness that is constant towards us. We give you all the praise this morning. Thank you for the first 10 months of this year. Thank you for the last 2 months. Thank you for where we are. Thank you for the expected end that you have promised us. Lord, as we listen to your word this morning, we ask that you will inspire us. You will instruct us. You will cause our faith, Lord, to be lifted up. And your name alone will be glorified. Thank you, Heavenly Father. In Jesus' mighty name, we are praying. Come on, say it louder. Amen. Welcome somebody to your right and to your left. Say, you're welcome to church. Welcome to the 11th month. The Lord bless you. Amen. Please take your seat in God's presence and sit down majestically. Hallelujah. So this month, we have a focus that says, you know, it's the only month of the year that starts with a no. So I'm going to be speaking to us this morning on how to say no by faith. How to say no by faith. Make sure that your phone is not distracting you, or else I will ask the angels to shut it down. Amen. That's the dimension. I can just ask an angel to shut it down. You will just find out that the battery goes very old and everything will shut down. And then when we finish the service, you will press it, you will come back again. Amen. Yes, it's by the anointing. Amen. So welcome to November, the only month that starts with no. And we are keen into that to speak on the topic this morning, how to say no by faith. Last week, for those of us that were in church, I began to paint to us that faith is important. Faith is a way by which you can live the supernatural life. What you have in Christ is called the Zoe life, which is higher than the animal life, is higher than the plant life, is higher than the human life. So the believer that has accepted Christ has, you know, keyed into the life of God. And the life of God is not a natural life, it's a supernatural life. And how we live that life of God is by faith. You see, you live the life of the human by food. At least you need food. That's why in Matthew chapter 4, the Bible will say, man shall not live by bread alone. Because bread is key. The moment bread ceases, bread is going to cease eventually. The moment food ceases and nothing comes into your system, the spirit will have to go. Because you see, the body is what carries the spirit. And the moment the body dies, the spirit will have to go. Of course, the spirit does not die, but you will have to leave the body. So the human body lives on food, but the spiritual life that you have lives on the word. And when the word comes into you, what it produces is faith. So while food comes into you and produces the energy that carries your physical life, when word comes into you, it produces faith that powers the supernatural life. Is somebody hearing what I'm talking about this morning? So that's why the Bible says in Romans chapter 10 verse 17, it said faith cometh by hearing, and hearing the word of God. You can as well be a believer and be dead. In the course of the month, I'm going to talk to you about the levels and dimensions of faith. When you gave your life to Christ, everybody was given the measure of faith. You and I were given the measure of faith. But if you don't feed your faith, you can come back to a place where the Bible says, Jesus said to them, how come you have no faith? A person can get back to that place. He can be called the title of a believer, but live as a doubter. He has no outer of faith in him. He's a person of no faith. So he's not living the supernatural life that he's been called to live. He's not living by faith. But the Bible says that the just shall live by faith. That's not the human life. That's the supernatural life. And you can be a believer and come to church and not live the supernatural life. And the devil can still mess you up and oppress you and take the things that rightfully belong to you because you don't understand that the just should live by faith. So what he was saying in that scripture is that the supernatural life is prosecuted by faith. That's why I pity believers who say they are believers and don't have the word of God in them richly. You are like a malnourished person who is suffering from some kwashiorkor and some other diseases. Your energy of the spirit to power the divine life within you will be zero or next to nothing. Your battery in the realm of the spirit can be absolutely dry. And your supernatural life can shut down so that you will begin to prosecute life by the things you hear, the things you see, the things that you can feel. The news that bother Canadians will bother you. The things that trouble the world will trouble you. The reason why you come into that place is because you have shut down your supernatural life, which is to be prosecuted by faith. You are not living by the news. You are living by bad news, not by the gospel. So a believer can just live on shawarma and live on rice and live, but that's not the supernatural life. That's the life that everybody lives. But that's not the life that we've been called to. We've been called to tower above situations and circumstances. We've been called to live a good life irrespective of what happens in your environment. You've been called to the dimension where others say there is a casting down, you can say there is a lifting up. The dynamics of you saying something different from what they are saying is because you are prosecuting life on a higher pedestal than where they are. So we can all put on suits and go to the same workplace, but we are not in the same economy. We're not in the same situation. When people say, you know, these things happen to all men. No, we are not them. They are not us. Come on now. We are different. Until you understand that you are different, you will live life like an ordinary man. You can be powerful and yet live like somebody who has no power. That's why knowledge is key. Hosea chapter 4 verse 6 said, my people are destroyed for the lack of knowledge. So that's just an introduction on the subject matter of faith. Faith is critical. Faith is pivotal. Faith is foundational to your supernatural life. You are not a Christian because you answer Christiana. You are a Christian because you are living by faith. It's not your name. It's what you live by. You are called to live by faith. The just shall live by faith. And so many of the times we only understand faith in the perspective of saying yes to God. And many people don't understand that faith also says no. Let me say to your neighbor, say faith also says no. Yeah. Many people just know God said it, I believe it, and just say yes to him. But you don't understand that faith also says no. There will be dimensions and situations that you will come to in life that if all you say is yes to God and you don't learn to say no to the situation and no to the devil can still oppress you. So Titus chapter 2 verse 11 is our anchor scripture for this month. Titus chapter 2 verse 11 and 12. It said, for the grace of God has appeared that offers salvation to all people. He teaches us to say no. So there are two key things there. The grace of God has appeared. And what he does is that he brings salvation to all people. And then he said the second dimension of that grace of God is that the grace of God teaches us to say no to ungodliness and worldly passions and to live self-controlled, upright, and godly lives in this present age. You see, the accurate translation of that scripture is how that grace teaches us to say no to sin. But I'm also going to take it to a higher dimension that he only does not teach us how to say no to sin, he also teaches us to say no to the things that flow out of sin. Including sickness, including affliction. He teaches us to say no to the things that are not godly. Poverty is not godly. Sickness is not godly. To be single at a time when you're supposed to be married becomes an ungodly thing. So the moment what God has planned for you is no longer finding manifestation in your life, that's a time to activate your faith and say no. Teaching us to say no to ungodliness. Teaching us to say no to wickedness. Because I've seen believers who have the testimony of the fact that they are giving their life to Christ and yet they are living under oppression. I've seen testimonies of people who say they are giving their lives to Christ but yet their life does not seem to be in accurate sync with what it should have been. There is a teaching of faith that teaches us to say no. Somebody say no. You see, one of the things that I love about no is the fact that it's not a big word. It's a small word, but it's very powerful. It's a small word, just two letters, N-O. But it's so powerful that if you can say it with conviction, he has the capacity to put an end to any big thing in your life. So you will have seen the doctor, and the doctor said, what you have is meningitis, blah, 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 blah. You can say no. Just two letter words. yet it carries tremendous power when it's powered by faith. The doctor can give you a report. You know how my pastor, my father in the Lord, Reverend Albert Oduwole, will say, when doctors write the bill, the thing will be clear. But when they write prescription, their writing will not be clear. And then they will write jargons and jargons that only a pharmacist can interpret. And they are writing something that is not good for you. So the intention is that you will not know how to read it. Somebody will have to say it. You see, the problem with what you hear is that it has the capacity to kill your faith. So when they write it for you and you cannot read it, but they give it to somebody that can tell you, the moment you hear it and your faith is not activated, it becomes your portion. It becomes your portion. Because the same way faith comes by hearing, that's the same way fear comes by hearing. The first thing I want you to know before I dive deeper into this morning is Ephesians chapter 2 verse 8. Ephesians chapter 2 verse 8. He said, for it is by grace that you are being saved through faith. Somebody say through faith. Because what you see in Titus chapter 2 verse 11 to 12 is that the grace of God has appeared. But you see, how do we take and appropriate the grace of God? He said it is through faith. So grace is like, somebody fills this whole place with money. This whole room fills it with money. For you to access this money and then he locks the door, faith is the key to access grace. So you see, the reason why you are saved and somebody out there is not saved is not because God has not saved them. It's because they have not taken the key to enter into the salvation. God didn't die for believers. Jesus died for all men. For God so loved the world. He didn't say for God so loved the church. For God so loved the world. So the difference between you and the unsaved world is because you have taken faith to accept grace, but they have still not accessed grace. So he says, it is the grace, it is by grace that you have been saved. So you see, when God wants to do anything on earth, he does it by grace. That grace is in the office of Jesus Christ. The love of God, the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit. When God wants to spend, he spends in Jesus. But for him to spend Jesus in your life, he said you must believe. So you find out that every time Jesus came to do miracles and all of that, he would talk about faith. Because what releases grace is faith. A person can carry grace and still walk in disgrace if he does not release faith. Faith is what unlocks the house of grace. So you see, most of the things that happens to people is not because the grace of God cannot take care of it. It's because they have not released grace to appropriate grace. There is nothing that will happen despite the presence of grace until faith is released. So Bible says it is by grace that you are saved, but he walks through faith. Somebody say through faith. That's why the subject matter of faith is important. There were two teams on the cross with Jesus. One was saying something, you know, idiotic. The other one was saying, I believe you. And right there at the verge of crossing into eternal damnation, by faith, one crossed into life. The other one continued into death. Faith releases grace. Even in his bleeding state and almost died, he could still say, today, you will be with me in paradise. Just because you identify grace and you release faith. So God's power is made available. God's power is made available, is released. The problem is not the availability of power. The problem is the availability of faith. You remember the story of that guy that came to Jesus and said, if you can do anything, Jesus said, stop it. And it's not that I can do anything, I can do all things. You are the one that needs to believe. If you have faith, all things are possible unto you. Ephesians chapter 6 verse 16. He said, above all, taking the shield of faith. So faith is not just an arrow. Faith is also a shield. So while faith can take things from God, faith can say no to the devil. How many of you know the devil can be resisted? If you are not possible, Bible wouldn't say it. He says, submit yourself to God. That's like saying, key into grace. Release your faith and resist the devil and he will flee from you. He didn't say the devil will argue with you. He said he will flee. Even if he has 10 arms, he said he will flee. It means that you are powerful when you operate in faith. Your power is in faith, not in your senses. Your greatest advantage is not your degree or your beauty, is your faith. Because the days will come when the Bible calls it an evil day that nothing else will matter except your faith. Those days always come upon every man. Oh, that's why I said to young people, don't just marry a woman that is beautiful, marry a woman that has faith. Because when life begins to happen, you will find out that there are more important things than beauty. Don't look for six pack. Six pack without faith is flat. It's a deficit in the journey of life. Because the days will come in the journey of life that what you will need will be faith. Every man goes through it. Be it a man of God or a woman of God. Every man. That's how to prosecute the supernatural life. The just shall live by faith. The days will come when your money will not come. There are things that money cannot do, sir. Oh, there are things that money cannot do. There are things that influence cannot do. There are gates. You've seen people who have money, yet sickness kill them. There are things that money cannot do. So the Bible did not say the just will live by money, as important as money is. The Bible didn't say the just shall live by their beauty, as important as that is. It didn't say the just shall live by their degree or by their connection. He said that you know that the just cannot even live by the anointing. The just cannot live by the anointing, because the funny thing about the anointing is that you can feel anointed this minute and feel unanointed the next minute. This time the worship is going on and the hand of the Lord is upon you and you can command the dead to rise up. You can be in a situation yourself when Jezebel will write you a letter and you will take off. The anointing that was working upon Elijah and Mount Carmel had been lifted when the letter of Jezebel or the messenger of Jezebel came to him. So you cannot prosecute the divine life by anointing, as good as anointing is. The anointing upon a man of God helps him to minister to others. It is by his faith that he lives his own life. Hallelujah. So I can come and say, you get up. And yes, the person is sick. The one who is ministering healing is sick. You have not. It happens. A man of God is dying. He's putting his hands on his dead wife. The dead wife wakes up by the anointing upon him. Yet he dies. You see how important faith is? Every man must build his or her own faith. Every man. So that's why the Bible didn't say the just shall live by his pastor's faith. He said the just shall live by his faith. His faith. The reason why you must be committed to hearing the word of God for yourself is because you cannot live by the word that is in the spirit of your pastor. You cannot live by the word that is in the spirit of your mother. You cannot live by the word that is in the spirit of your father. You must live by the word that is in your spirit. And you know, the 21st century has made it easy. 2 nights ago, I just plugged my AirPods in and I was listening to the book of John. Before I slept, the guy read it up to about John chapter 8. You know, because I know what he was reading. As he was reading it, I was just following him. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God. And God was, when he got to chapter 2, I said, oh, that's the beginning of chapter 2. When he got to chapter 3, when he got to chapter 8, I'm like, oh, this thing is sweet. So even when you are lazy and you can't open the Bible, somebody can read it to your ears. Praise God. Them apostles of old, they didn't have that one. That's the reason when you suffer things you are not supposed to suffer, your angels are like, what's the matter with you? The resources that are available at your disposal to prosecute the divine life, to build faith, it has never been in the history of mankind. Messages has never been open to people like it is open to us in our generation. Books. You used to have to travel to the West to go and buy books. Now you can download books on your phone. Even free ones by PDF. It's circulated all over. Kenneth Hagin, Copeland, all of them. Yet, we are that faithless generation. You remember the lamentation of Jesus. He said, when I come back upon the earth, will I meet faith? He didn't say, will I meet the anointing? He said, will I meet faith? Because there is a possibility that faith goes into extinction because the sons of men, the daughters of men, decide to live by sense. You can have a church that lives by sense. It's so easy for me to just come here and teach the wisdom of men. And I can speak plain English and tell you about, you know, motivation, all that. That's not how to live life. The days will come upon you when the devil will knock your door by fear. And what you need to answer with is faith. Your grammar will not matter in that day. Somebody says, when fear knocks your door, let faith open the door for you. You see, the fact that you are a believer does not mean that the devil will not knock your door. That's the beauty of your faith. Because the only way we can know that you have faith is when challenges come to you and you overcome them. That's the only way. We can know that you have faith. In 2 Chronicles chapter 32, we saw the story of Hezekiah. Hezekiah was a king of Israel. And the Bible says the king of Assyria came against Jerusalem. The king of Assyria came against Jerusalem and besieged it, locked down the city. And was saying, don't let Hezekiah deceive you. Your God cannot save you. We are the world power. We are the intercontinental ballistic missile. We have nuclear weapons. We have leveled other countries around you. How much is your body? You know how they say it. How much is your body? Please, is it not small, Israel? How many people are you? We are going to level you. When you have time, go and read 2 Chronicles chapter 32 and see the response of Hezekiah, a man of faith. A man of faith. See, life will happen to all of us. How we react to life is a function of our faith level. There is nothing that is going to happen to you that has not happened to somebody before. The difference between you and them will be the level of faith that is at work in you. Hezekiah said, forget this guy. He just went to God. He said, our God is able to save us. He said, with him is an arm of flesh, but with us, we have the living God. The problem is that most of the time, you talk to God about how big your problem is. You don't tell your problem how big your God is. Hezekiah was saying to them, they that are with us are more than they that are with them. We see their horses, but these horses are animal horses, fleshly horses. The horses from heaven, they don't use blood. They are supernatural horses. And when you have this knowledge, this confidential trust in God, it changes your perspective about the issues of life. You can be in the midst of trouble and be as calm as a river just because you know that God is on your side. It makes all the difference. In 2 Kings chapter 4 from verse 8 to verse 36, 2 Kings chapter 4 from verse 8 to verse 36, you see the story of the woman that was wealthy and perceived that Elisha was a prophet of God and made a room for Elisha in her house. And then as a result of her kingdom investment, the prophet asked his servant, what can we do for this woman? Should we speak to the king or to the captain for her? And the woman said, I'm amongst my people. I am blessed. It's just that there is something about my life that is not working. And as I said, I perceive that I can't hear the shout of any son or any baby in this house. And then the prophet prophesied to her, by this time next year, let me prophesy at this juncture to somebody. Whatever needs to be done in your life that is yet undone, according to the time of life, before this time next year, you will have your testimony. Amen. You need to perceive that I'm a prophet of God anyway. Because what I found out is that it's not so much about who speaks to you, it is whether you believe who speaks to you. Bible said that Jesus went into his own village. And the people said, look at this guy, J-E-S-U-S. Is it not Jesus, the son of Mary and Joseph? Bible says he could do no big miracle there. He couldn't. Because they didn't accept him. They didn't understand that even though he was born amongst them, there was something different about him. So this woman gave back to the child, and the child was growing. He grew up to be a fine son. And then the Bible says one day he went to the field with his father, and then there was this satanic headache that was sponsored from the pit of hell. See, when God gives you a breakthrough, the devil wants it to turn to a breakdown. That's why you need faith. Faith to get what God has given, yet faith to maintain what God has given. You see that? You need faith to get it. You need faith to keep it. For the Bible says that the thief cometh not, but to steal, to kill, and to destroy. So you will not, because many people have faith before they get married, but when they get married, they lose faith. It takes faith to get married. It takes faith to give birth to babies. It takes faith to raise the children. It takes faith to keep the family. It takes faith to get the job. It takes faith to keep the job. The devil can still contend with the things that God has given to you. That man of God said he had a vision where I was talking to Jesus, and a demon was disturbing the conversation, and he was saying to Jesus, can't you see this guy? He said, me, demon. No, that's your level. Because when Jesus died and rose up, Bible says, having spoiled principalities and powers, he made an open show of them. The word spoil is to strip. He flogged them. He put up their dress, ran them naked on the street of eternity, and then sealed it. Say, you guys, you are not in March. When he came back to the disciples, he said, all power in heaven, on earth, and beneath the earth. So it means that the devil was not left with any power. If Jesus said, all power, what the devil now has is devices. And if you are ignorant, ignorant of the devices. Devices can be powerful. Yeah. Devices can be powerful. So it's not so much about the power of the devil. It's about the devices of the devil. The devices, the schemes, the wiles. Bible calls it the fiery darts of the devil. The devil can mess up your mind. So this woman, Bible says, the child came back. The father said, I don't want to talk about that kind of father today. The father said his child was dying. He didn't know what to do. Don't marry a man that has muscle. Don't marry a man that just has money. Marry a man of faith. That's key. The days will come. Imagine that if that woman was not a woman of faith, that only breakthrough that she got in the 11th hour. She must have known at the point the prophet encountered her. The devil is a bad devil on Monday, on Tuesday, on Wednesday, on Thursday, on Friday, on Saturday, on Sunday, even on holidays. The devil is a bad devil. He can take a child from a woman who gave birth to a child at 60 and take a husband from a woman who got married at 45. He doesn't give a damn. His job is to take, to steal, to kill, and to destroy. You are the one that will say no. Somebody shout no this morning. Your faith must be provoked. So the Bible says the boy came back home and died. My God, what died in your hands? And then the Bible says the woman took the baby and took the baby to the room of the prophet and laid the baby. Thank God for a woman of faith. She didn't cry about it. She didn't murmur about it. That's the beauty of faith. The reaction of faith is different from the reaction of fear. The reaction of faith is different from the reaction of fear. Fear stops. Faith is calm. One of the ways you will know a man of faith, a woman of faith, is that in the day of his or her trouble, she is calm. Said the man of God was traveling, and then the car they were in had an accident, and his wife died. Others were weeping. The owner of the wife was walking about. As he was walking about, he was praying in the Holy Ghost. Because when they left house that morning, God didn't tell them that his wife was going to die. So he was calm and just speaking, and then the Holy Ghost spoke to him, go and speak to her. See, you cannot hear the Holy Ghost when you are perturbed. Yes. The prayer of fear does not move God. It's the prayer of faith. Yes. So when you react like that, there was no substance to you. If you faint in the day of adversity, he said there was nothing much to you in the first place. So in the day of adversity, men of faith, men who are loaded with faith, they are calm. They begin to talk to the Lord. Because you see, the economy of the mingled spirit is that God is not far from you. God is actually within you. So if you know him and you are prosecuting your Christian life, you will begin to speak to him and say, Lord, what is happening here? What is happening here? What's happening here? You begin to speak, what's happening here? If you can do it, he will speak to you. God is not away from us. God is not a bad father. God is not far. The problem is that you don't know him. I was speaking to you here about how that a man ran mad within in the middle of a service and everybody was perturbed. Everybody was, what were we? I mean, that's unheard of. In the midst of service, it was a rain of affliction. The rain came for about 1 minute. It was a rain. And then when I sat, I was like, oh God, what's happening here? And then they bundled him, took him to the pastor's office. Unfortunately for all of us, the pastor was not around. And then as I was praying in tongues, and the Holy Ghost said, go lay hands upon him. You will hear him. When you are calm, be still and know that I am God. Be still. Don't be perturbed. You see, what the devil wants you to do is to run out of Jerusalem. When he blows the trumpet of fear, go and read 2 Chronicles chapter 32. What the Bible says that Hezekiah was in Jerusalem. Jerusalem means the land of peace. The place where you can pick God up is in peace. Retain your calmness. Be cool. Be calm. Be collected. It's a disposition of faith. Shouting and crying is a disposition of fear. It means that you don't know that your God is alive. You don't know. You don't know. You don't know. And that's why you see people say, I called him. He didn't answer. You weren't calling him. You weren't calling him. You are shouting out of fear. When your prayer is 99% perspiration and 1% faith, it does not work. It doesn't work. It doesn't work. You must build faith. The economy of faith must be built into you that you know. Come on now. How many knows? You keep on knowing. I have a pastor friend, a senior pastor friend, who will say, I know more than I know my name. That's the way you must know God. You know, David said, yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. If you enter that valley of the shadow, some people will already die. They just die. It's still the shadow, not the death itself. They just die like, you know, I had an accident many years ago. I was traveling with my parents, and then I overtook a vehicle, and there was an oncoming trailer. It was a good point of overtaking. I had returned back to my lane, and there wasn't supposed to be anything. And then this trailer guy was just angry that I overtook, or the devil was sponsoring me, and then he left his own lane and came to face us. Now the thing is that most of the people die not out of death, they die out of fear. Because when you see that kind of a scene, the normal thing that a man of fear does is that he now takes off his hand from the steering and says, hey, how does that save you? The steering was given to you to drive the car. You now let the steering to the devil and say, I take. No. Faith will hold that steering calmly and try his best, and then God will come. There is no recording of the accident. You will have known that he was God. It was God that saved us. But you needed faith. Now, when we let all that money, we didn't sign up for that. We didn't sign up for that. So faith will stay calm. This woman locked the door of the room and took a journey to the prophet. What faith does in the day of trouble is that faith finds God in the midst of trouble. When you are a person of faith in the midst of trouble, your faith finds God. God is always around in the day of trouble. God is always around. But it is only faith that can find God. Fear drives him away. Because the Bible says that he has not given us the spirit of fear. It's not his spirit. You shouldn't take it. So when you saw that woman physically going to the prophet, that's the picture of how faith navigates in the midst of trouble. Faith does not cry about the trouble. Faith leaves the trouble and finds God. He finds God. Lord, where are you in the midst of this? Lord, where are you in the midst of this? And then you see, life will begin to ask you questions. People will begin to say to you, is it well with you? Faith will keep on saying it is well. The Bible says they met her, the servant of the prophet, said, is it well? If he was a person of faith, he would say, oh, it's not well. That's not a story to say to a man. Find God and tell him about the situation. The problem is that many of the time, we want to tell the world about our situation because we are not people of faith. If Facebook could help you, they would have helped you. So you go and put your matter on Facebook. The day you are good, you say chilling things. Then the day, if we look at your Facebook timeline and your Instagram, we can pick your mood. We know where you are. The days of the good one, we know the days of the bad one. That's not how to prosecute the supernatural life. Your faith will find God in the midst of your trouble. Am I preaching to somebody this morning? So when she got to the prophet, he said, bros, come. Bros, come. I didn't tell you I was looking for a child. This child cannot die. It's not. You see, the way faith speaks, faith does not speak the situation. Faith speaks revelation. You are talking about a child that is dead, and you are saying he must not die. So you are not talking about the death, you are talking life. Bible says in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. The earth was without form and void, and darkness was upon the face of the deep. The Spirit of the Lord did not speak about darkness. The Spirit of the Lord moved upon the surface of the deep. And when God was going to speak, God said, let there be light. And there was light. Faith does not speak about the situation. So I have headache, I have sickness in my body. When the Bible says, let the weak say, I am strong. He wasn't saying form it, he was saying speak it out of your convictions. Speak it. Don't talk about what is happening, talk about what should happen. Don't talk about what you are seeing, talk about what you have faith for. Because the devil attacks your sight, your ears, your feelings. Have you had people say, I just feel sick? Even when the sickness has not come, because they feel sick, they will not fall sick. It takes you to feel sick before you fall sick. Don't speak the situation. Speak out of revelation. How did he speak light in the midst of utter darkness? He meditated as the Spirit was brooding upon the atmosphere. That's meditation. So when I go into the Word of God, I find out what God is saying about me, so that when I speak, I don't say what the devil is saying. I say what the Word says. I say what the Word says. I say what the Word says. It doesn't matter what the situation is. I am not a situation talker. I'm a speaker of revelations. So let's quickly get to how to say no by faith, because I'm running out of time. So you know the rest of that story. The woman got the baby back to life. Go and read all that the prophet had to do. Faith will provoke God to do everything that God has to do about your case. God cannot look away from faith. He cannot. He is compelled to respond to faith. Anywhere Jesus finds faith, he will put power there. The prophet came in, laid hands upon the baby. The baby didn't wake up. The Bible says he now laid down on the baby, mouth to mouth, hand to hand. He passed all of his prophetic unction. He put his calling on the line and said, "This woman put this child on my bed. This woman took the distance and came to me because of her faith. Whatever it will cost you to bring this child back to life, it must come back." Faith provokes the hand of God. If it's not working, sir, it's not faith. Take it or leave it. The moment you put it, it's not working. Go and recalibrate. There is an element of fear within it. Go and recalibrate. Go back into the Word and invest in the Word. Invest in the Word. Yeah, you remember my father in the Lord said he had issues with his leg, and then he took a trip out of Nigeria, went somewhere in London, I think, and locked himself up in an hotel room and began to gather healing scriptures. Because you can be a man of God. It's not every time that your faith is here. You are not always full of faith. Because you live by faith, so you can deplete your faith on a daily basis. In fact, it's not terrible for a man of God. Every time I pray for you, I'm depleting my faith. The reason why I must spend time with God is because if I'm not careful, I can spend my faith on people, and then in the day of my own trouble, there will be no faith to spend. So I must stay there and build faith. It's easy to preach. This one I'm preaching is for you. You build faith by it. So when I preach like this, I go back every Sunday. I listen to this sermon like 2 times, 3 times. So if you preach, I preach it to you, you only add it once. Glory to God. You're on your own. I that preached it. Because you find out that many of the times, the things that you prepared are not the things that you say. There is an unction, there is an anointing that comes upon you that brings the things that God wants to say. That act. So you have to listen to be blessed by it yourself. You can fall into that error and bless people and still die of your own disease. The Bible says that Elisha died of his disease, yet his dead bone was raising a dead man. That's the pastor. He died, sickness killed him, but there was sufficient power in his bones to wake up a dead man. So an anointed man can die, yet he's anointed to heal others. How do I say no by faith? Number one, you must know what God says about you in the world. See, when we say go and read the Bible, we're not trying to... I don't know how to say this. Because there is no other way. There is no other way. If Facebook will help you, we will have told you. Say, be reading Facebook. It's a fake book. The real book is your Bible. That's where life is. Man shall not live by bread alone. Man shall not live by Instagram alone. Man shall not live by YouTube alone. Man shall not live by Zoom alone. Man shall not live by Facebook and Snapchat. All of those things are deceptions of the devil. If you can't find the Word of God there, the devil is deceiving you. Man must live by the Word. Faith comes by it. Have you noticed that what is called news in the world is bad news? Yes. Good news is not news. I had a distinction in journalism. You are not trained to look out for good news. You must have nose. That's what they call it. You have nose for news. And what makes news is bad news. When you hear that 21 story building fell, that's where you carry your camera. The one that is going up that did not fall. This news. Say, this is Channel TV. We just found out in Amazon that the 21 story building. And then when you hear it, you see. They just pass fear into you. 25%. And then you flip from that place, you face another place, and then they tell you,
the aircraft that was flying from Arizona to New Jersey, it just came down and 300 people died. You're like, hey!
Your faith that is there, 30% went. 20%. That's how you die on a daily basis.
Yes.
So if you don't plug yourself into the word of God and you listen to the news that comes from the word, your faith will die. Your fear will be alive. So when cockroach enters your room, you will say, because your fear is now more than your faith. That's how you shout. When you have a dream that you're supposed to wake up and say, I cancel that in the name of the Lord, you will now wake up. You'll be looking for your grandmother's phone number. What's your problem? We don't live by dream, we live by faith. We don't live by dream. It doesn't matter how bad the dream is. If there is sufficient faith in your spirit, you can cancel the dream. How many times will people tell you they dreamt about you? They dreamt about you. Somebody said he had a dream. In his dream, he was beaten. He woke up and he told himself, how can you come into my dream and beat me? So he prayed and slept back and continued the dream and called back the person and beat the person. That's how to live by faith.
Yes.
Because the moment you wake up and you accept the dream, it is done. It is done. You must come to that realm. My mom will say, if you bring down food, you will not just go. She will sit you down and feed you with the food. That's faith. Sit you down. Open your mouth. In the dream. So it means that when faith is in your spirit, even in your dream life, you are active.
Yes, yes.
You are not one that can be oppressed in the dream. You are a living spirit.
Hallelujah.
A living spirit is alive even when you are asleep in the body. Your spirit man is alive. Said he was in his room, and then one woman, they were living in one story building, and there was a witch living upstairs. And you know, when a witch sees a prophet, they know each other. And then the witch came into her room. She was sleeping. From the sleep, she recited a psalm, a whole chapter of psalms. Even in the physical, she doesn't know the whole chapter, but in the spirit, there is a way you can load the word into your spirit that your spirit knows the word than your head. So the Bible is not for you to keep in your brain. It's to keep in your spirit. By meditation, the word of God comes alive in your spirit. It's a living word. The word of God is quick and powerful, sharper than any two-edged sword. So it's a sword in the realm of the spirit.
Amen.
You must spend time in the word and know what God is saying about you. Number two, you must believe. Don't just read. Believe. Believe the word. Isaiah chapter 53 verse 1. Who has believed our report? And to whom is the arm of God revealed? The revelation of the arm of God comes because of a belief of the report of God. Don't just read, read to believe. The stories can look like, this story is interesting. Oh, so you mean the baby died and yet the prophet came? Who does that? Jesus does that. Who does that? Jesus. Yeah, the supernatural. That's the reason they documented it for you, so that you can enter into the realm of the supernatural and believe that the impossible is possible with God. For Matthew 19:26 says that with men this is impossible, but with God all things are possible.
Hallelujah.
Believe. A woman said her husband was a drunkard, and she began to intercede and pray for the husband. And one of those days while she was praying, God spoke to her and said, your husband will not die as a drunkard. And then the guy kept on drinking, and one day had an accident on his way back from the pub and died. And they were planning burial. So the woman had the gist and said, that's not what God told me. Come on now. It's a dead man, but that's not what God told me. God told me he will not die. You see, the devil is a bad devil, like I keep on saying to you. He wants to make God a liar. You are the one that will say, let God be true and let every man be a liar. So she took the dead body, said, you guys stay outside. Locked herself in the room with the dead body and said, God, remember your word. You are not a man that you should lie, neither you a son of man that you should repent. The strength of Israel will not lie. Hebrews chapter 6 verse 18, by two immutable things. How you know that you believe the word of God is that you act based on it. It is not faith if it is not acted. You must act because you believe the word. Pray first hour, second hour. Faith does not give up. I'm going to teach you about the characteristics of faith in the subsequent weeks of this month. We're going to be talking faith. Fourth hour, fifth hour, sixth hour, stay there. Faith stays. Faith is persistent. Faith does not give up. Faith does not take no for an answer. If I can find it in the word, I can stay there and say that God is not a liar. In the seventh hour, the man sneezed and came back. He's been dead for a couple of hours. A woman of faith. You go and read the book of Hebrews. He said, by faith, women receive their dead back to life.
Yeah.
Women, he particularly said women. Because maybe men were too logical to believe that a dead person could rise up. But women, they were tenacious. They received their dead back to life. They believed the report of the Lord. Number three, you must refuse and fight whatever does not align with the report of God. You refuse it, you fight it. Faith is a gentleman, yet faith is a warrior. The father of faith, Abraham, was a civilian. Yet in his house, there were 318 soldiers that were trained for battle. You would have thought that Abraham was a bloody civilian until the day that his niece Lot was taken captive. And one came and told him that Lot has been taken captive. I thought that this guy was a gentleman. He was just a farmer. But you see, inside a farmer of faith, there is a fight of faith. I can be a pastor, but faith is a fighter. Faith is a fighter. So when they told Abraham that Lot had been taken off, he took 318 servants, trained in his house, and went to battle, and he won. Faith always wins. Faith is a fighter. So you refuse what God has not said about you. You contend against him. Hebrews chapter 11 verse 24. Faith says no. It was by faith that Moses, when he grew up, refused to be called the son of Pharaoh's daughter. So the world can call you anything. They can say you are single. The world can say you are poor. The world can say you are a nobody. They can say you are an average man. They can tell you that your life is full of struggle. Faith refuses. By faith, Moses refused to be called. What are they calling you? You refuse it. Faith says, no, I refuse it. That's not who I am. That's not what the word of God says about me. I refuse it. So your faith must refuse. If your faith does not refuse, the devil will give you what is not yours. He will take what is yours and give you what is not yours. So your faith must say no. Somebody say no.
No.
You are not saying it like you mean it. Say no.
No.
Come on, shout it. Say no.
No.
Can you rise up to your feet this morning? I don't have time. We're going to continue from here next week. I just want you to pray, and I want to agree with you this morning. Is there anything in your life that you want us to say no to this morning? Under this corporate anointing, pain, sickness, whatever it is, just lift up your hand to God. Just lift up your hand to God and let's say no together. Let's say no together. Just go ahead and pray and say, Jesus, I say no. I say no. That unpalatable situation, I say no. That thing that is already bothering your mind, the devil wants to make it a trend. Can you say no to it this morning? If your faith can say no convincingly, God will take what you say. So I say no to pain. I say no to sickness. I say no to tragedy. I say no to whatever the devil is planning over my home, over my life, over my career, over my business, over my ministry, over my children. I say no. I say no. Say it like you mean it this morning. We say no, this is the month of November. We say no to sickness. We say no to affliction. We say no to poverty. We say no to suffering in the name of Jesus. We say no to death in our lives, in our homes. We say no, come and say no this morning. Take a minute and say no. Take a minute and say no. Let the devil hear you. Let the devil hear you. Don't say no like a graduate of Oxford. Don't say no like a graduate of Harvard. Say no like you mean it. I say no. For the Lord is a shield unto me. We say no this morning. We say no this morning. This is the victory that overcomes the world. Even our faith. I say no to sickness. In your body this morning, I said no to untimely death. I said no to pain in your body. I said no. I said no. Whatever you said no to this morning, I said no to them. I have not been in emotion. Lift up your two hands to the Lord. Lord, we say no. We say yes to the things that you say yes to, but we say no to the things that you are not saying. We say no to the things that the devil is saying. We come against principalities and powers. We reject the report of darkness. We say no to sicknesses, to pains in the body. We say no to evil trends in our families. We say no to evil foundations. We say no this morning. We say no in the name of Jesus. We We reject every report of darkness. Even the things that we don't know about yet, that the devil has planned as a time bomb to come up in the future, to marital delays, to failed families, to failed marriages. We say no to them. We say no to every plantation of sickness in your body. Whatever is yet to show up, that the devil has planned to show up for you in the future. Bible says, as soon as they hear my voice, they will be afraid and come out of their close places. I catch every sickness planned to come out in the future. We say no to them. In the name of Jesus, we say no to untimely death. As this year goes to an end, no evil shall befall you. No weapon fashioned against you shall prosper. In the name of Jesus, whatever be the trend in your family that is negative, come and put your right hand on your head. I come against it right now in this service. We say no to that trend. We say no to that trend. We say no to that evil flow. In the name of Jesus, we say no to it. Whatever that is unpalatable that happened to your parents, it will not have a repeat in your life. You are released from it in the name of Jesus. Oh, Shatabala Kabakantele Debos. Woo, we give you praise and glory. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Can I say no to the spirit of fear? Right now, right now, right now, under the sound of my voice, every spirit of fear, I come against you. We say no to you. We command you to go out now in the name of Jesus. There is a pain in the stomach somewhere. Can you put your right hand on it? I want to charge it this morning. I come against that pain in the stomach. I come against that pain. I come against that pain. In the name of Jesus, I command you to go. I'm no longer a slave to fear. Come and sing it. Sing it right now. I am. Say I'm no longer a slave to fear. I'm a child of God. I'm a child of God. Just wave your hands to him this morning and say, Father, thank you. We give you all the praise and glory. We give you all the praise and glory. Thank you, Abba. In Jesus' mighty name, we are praying. Amen. Please take your seat. The Lord bless you. Can you give the Lord a round of applause this morning?